Manuela. EPS in absentia, and as well as my fellow ministers. How David, I see you, my sister Sane. As well as to the larger congregation of CAF. Standing before you is Karabo. I am a son of God by default. Unfortunately, by default, I happen to be a psychologist, Jesus. But I love the Lord and I'm a son of God, amen. Amen. Above all things. Okay, so, you know, this is week 4 of the SOM, and the week continues. We are speaking about the words which are spirit and which are life, amen.
Amen.
So you'll find when different ministers come here in the front and share the word of God, they will share the heart of God from different angles. We have heard science, we heard as well Lesedi, body, soul, and spirit. We heard Tabang last week talking about the bread of life. Amen?
Amen.
So you will find that different ministers will share, based on the context, I hope, they will share the mind of God. Amen? I'm thankful for CAF. I came here, I remember, on the 19th of March, 2017. Yes, it was my first time here. Gabriel Omoroke was preaching. And I've been with CAF ever since. Amen?
Amen.
I was sitting there one day, sitting, thank you, one day. That was my chair. I think Bongikos was the chair during that time. And I started fellowshipping with CAF from then. What attracted me to this organization was the love of God I felt. Coming from Pretoria, I was doing my master's here. So I came here last year, and when I came here, the first 3 months were quite tough. I'm not used to beds, it's quite big. And the things you see here, the purple hairstyles, and everything is just so colorful. And I was shocked. I was like, it was a culture shock. I'm from Edwinsa, Edwinsa is quite small. Everything was just a shock. But when I was looking for a church for the past for 2 months, from January to Feb. So on the 19th of March, I found CAF. So I thank the Lord, amen. All right. So without wasting, please tell me that time. Okay. I hope I'll be able to see. All right. So let's go back to the context of John 6. Okay. SLM is so nice. Song is nice. We are taught hermeneutics so that we can accurately divide the weight. I used to be a runner before I joined Song. I used to be a runner. I would take one breath and run in error. In error, in darkness, I would run. But when I came to CAF, we did a module called hermeneutics, and they told us how to divide the weight line by line, precept by precept. Okay, so let's look at the context of John 6. Before we get to the words that I speak, we must understand which words was he speaking. Okay? So before we get there, we look at John 6, where John narrates the works and the ways of Jesus, right? So he starts by talking about Jesus crossing over to Galilee. When he gets there, he tests Philip's faith by multiplying the bread and the fishes. That was the miracle. We move, he then starts walking on the sea, on water, and the disciples are frightened. Okay? Then you go, you read, he speaks about the bread of life. And he says, you know, you are following me, not because of the miracles, but because you ate, and so your stomach is filled, and then you are following the food. And then he comes and he says to the multitude, labor not for the meat that perishes, but labor for meat which is eternal, which I am that. And he speaks about being the bread of life. So when he talks about laboring for that does not what does not perish, he's simply saying that labor for what is more spiritual. Lucidis touched on that last the week before. Lucidis touched on that when he spoke about body, soul, and spirit. So then Thabang Thabang also started sharing about the bread of life, Christ being the bread of life, and said, this bread is enough for our generation. Amen? Mm-hmm. That was what Thabang was saying last week. Fine. Then Jesus talks about the fact that no one can come to him except he be led by the Father. And that whoever comes to him, he will not reject. Amen? Amen. He says, I will not cast out whoever comes to me, but you can't come to me unless the Father draws you to me. Fine. He moves and he says, eat my flesh, drink my blood. This is the life, this is the way. There's no any other. And then, after he said that, the murmuring and the complaining, the murmuring and the complaining started. And the disciples, it says many of the disciples, then from that point, they stopped following him. They said, if we have to eat your flesh and drink your blood, you, the son of Joseph and Mary, then everyone backed off, right? And then Jesus comes and says, does this offend you? Does my doctrine offend you? Because the disciples were saying that this is a hard saying. How do you expect us to eat your flesh and drink your blood? And he says, does this offend you? And then he says, how more would you like to be offended when I ascend in glory? Rather be offended now than when I ascend, when you see me ascending in glory. And then after that, the Bible says that then people started departing and they no longer followed Jesus. Amen? So they followed him they stopped following him because his sayings were hard. Again. Alright. So many of the disciples, John 6, 66. So after he asked them if they were offended, he said, but the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. They are for more than the flesh. They are for more than meeting your needs. They are not for only the miracles that you saw me and the bread. They are not after the bread. This is the bread, meaning him. So, yes, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him because his words were hard. Amen? Right. Can you pray for the word? Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, O God. We give honor unto you and unto your word we resign ourselves. Father, we pray, O Lord, and we thank you that under your glory you have made us one, that us in Christ and Christ in us, Lord, may you be glorified. Father, we pray as we are about to partake in your word, we pray, Holy Spirit, that may we impart wisdom, but above all, Father, understanding, that Heavenly Father, we may move from knowledge, but Father, to understanding your word, and to living it and to practicing it. Father, we pray, O Lord, that may your word be glorified in each and every one of us, that Christ may live, that the hope of glory which is in us may be made manifest unto the world. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you all praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. So if I were to title my message, it would be Christ, the Rock of Offense. Amen? Amen. It's not the Christ that is preached. It's not the Christ that gives you what you want. But it is the Christ of which people stumble upon. Okay? So the Bible refers to him as a stumbling block. It refers to Christ as a rock of offense. It refers to him as the chief cornerstone that was rejected of men but allowed of God. Okay? And that Christ, we must be careful that he doesn't offend us. That we walk in offense in Christ. Amen? So let's go to Matthew 11:6. So here is Jesus saying, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Amen. Amen. Luke 7, 23 to 25 says. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Again, he says, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Amen.
Amen.
So what was happening? Again, we are SOM students, my God.
Oh, yeah.
I hope you're making, I'm kidding. So what was happening? Again, what was happening? So as Jesus was performing miracles, John sent out his disciples to ask if he was the Christ or if they were still waiting for another. You would think that John knew and could perceive Christ, but he didn't. He still had to ask him if he was the Christ. So the gospel that we preach, the Christ that we preach, if he were to appear to you in another way, would you perceive him? Or would he be a stumbling block upon which you stumble? So, okay, fine. And then the disciples come and they ask Christ. And he says to them, tell John this, that the lame people can walk, the blind can see. So he tells them that, tell John these miracles. Okay? And he said, blessed is he who is not offended in me. See, you can perceive, but when you have offense in your heart, you can't perceive. Seeing, they may see, but not perceive. Hearing, you hear, but don't understand. Amen? Fine. Let's go to 1 Peter 2. From verse 2, we'll flow with it. Okay, 3, 4. Okay. So it talks about. Let me take it from here. It talks about us being the lively stones. That Christ being the chief cornerstone, we are the lively stones, right? And we come unto him who is our stone. Who is a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. 5. You also, as lively stones, you are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believes on him shall not be confounded. 7. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, not believing, disobedient. The stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the cornerstone, of the corner. And a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto they were appointed. Amen? Amen. See, Christ, however we perceive Christ, determines how we walk with him. What we perceive, Sai says about representing what someone you do not know. That you can't represent someone you do not know, That you can't represent someone you do not know, right? Yes. So the Christ that we preach, the Christ that we live for, the one that we are saying we are giving ourselves away, that Christ can be a stumbling block unto us. That when we take heed of the word of God without understanding, then we do not practice the word of God. You can only practice what you understand, not what you know. All of us know the verses, Pastor. We can quote them. We know them. We know the verses. But how many of us understand? Solomon says, cry for understanding, not knowledge. Cry for understanding. Because crisis reveals what you understand. When that exam or nothing is going in, nothing is going in, and you're paging through the book. Nothing is going in here. Nothing is going in. What you understand about God, you practice that. How many of us know? We are young people. Before you're even born again, even like you even quoted, you're like, yeah, no, sex before marriage is sin. How many of us practice that? We know, but when it comes to practicing, it's like here there's a gap where all the knowledge gets filtered and then comes out, and then whatever is left gets practiced, but not all of it. Amen? What causes us to be offended in Christ? When Christ was busy preaching, when he was saying, I'm the bread of life, people saw a carpenter. People saw the son of Joseph and Mary, who was born in a manger one day, next day he's the bread, and we must eat. That's what people saw. That is what people saw. You see, that is what intellect does. That is what rationalization will do. That's what people saw. So what causes us to walk in offense in God? Being overly familiar with God. Getting used to God. David, when David saw Bathsheba, God gave him time to repent. From the moment that he saw, to the moment that he closed the window and stopped seeing, he had a choice to repent. When he devised the plan, he had a choice to repent. When he called Bathsheba, he had a choice to repent. When Bathsheba entered the room, he had a choice to repent. What happens when we get used to God? You get used to the favor of God. You get used to the victory, the breakthrough. I think you are getting them. You get used to the mercy of God. When you first walked in the faith, you wanted the Lord. You were there, intercession, you were there, prayer, you were there, fasting, you were there. And then you got used to God. And then you know what you do. What do you mean, cell phone? This is you in intercession. This is you. We are praying. As long as we are in the spirit, God is moving. And we are rabble shut. And you are on WhatsApp. You are not talking about anything godly. You are not checking your messages because they are godly and maybe there's an emergency, someone fainted and you need to pray. It's not that. It's just conversation that you thought you were expecting a message. See, you are in the presence of God and you are holding your cell phone. Not even taking selfies with an angel or with God. You're just scrolling. You're just looking at your private life and your messages in the presence of God. See, we get used to God, and that's where we miss him. When we start getting used to God, when the things of God become common, we handle them carelessly. If you give a child a gift and they are not matured, Jesus, you will see how that gift will be used. So we got God, we get used to these things. You get used to them. You even when you pray in the spirit, you're not led. You know, the brain is powerful. When you're led and you're praying in the spirit and you're led by the spirit, you will know that, okay, this is the Holy Spirit leading. I can feel it. You're not based on feelings, but you know. When your brain has memorized tongues, even when you pray, it's your memory. You can hear yourself. I think when you pray alone, you can hear yourself like, okay, rabba, rabba, okay. Then when you're led, you're like, okay, rabba, rabba, shora. Because it's your brain that is working. It's not you. It's not the spirit. See, when you treat grace as if it's something that is common, you trample upon the Son of God. And when you trample upon him, he becomes something that is a stumbling block. And when you stumble, you walk in error. Okay? So that's what they're saying. No, Son of Joseph, this carpenter. Yeah. Fine. What causes us to walk in offense? Unmet expectations. When God says no. When he's not the father of your breakthrough. When there's no breakthrough. And you are praying and you are doing everything that you were taught. And God still says no. Because why? He's not interested in feeding your flesh. He's interested in growing your spirit. You are as great as your spirit. You are as great as your spirit. John, when he writes, I like what John, you can go to 1 John 5. es John 2. Yes, yes. Ah. Go to verse 5. Yeah, I'll search for it myself. You know the one that verse that says, I write unto you, children, I write unto you, young men, I want that verse. 12. It's 2:12. Okay? Yeah. So, 12, try 12 before we get to 13 because I think this is a repetition. Yeah, okay. So he says, I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. That's little children. They are caught up with their sins are forgiven. That's all they know. My sins are forgiven, my sins are forgiven. It never moves beyond that. It's a relationship that is based on my sins are forgiven. So those are little children. And he says, I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. You know God. Father, when you have a relationship with God where you know God, you know that God is love. And if we were to summarize all his greatness, we would see love. Anyway, I want this young man. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. 14. I have written unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you. And you have overcome the wicked one. You are strong because of the word abides in you. And when the word abides in you, you are able to overcome. Without the word, you can pray, you can sing joyous 1, 2, what's the latest 20? You can sing. Some people love singing gospel more than they love reading the Bible. You can sing it out. You can sing. Bazalani, you can sing. I love songs. You can sing, but without the word of God dwelling richly in you. Richly in you. Some of us are addicted to skin time, television. But how many of us are addicted to the word where you feel like, 2 days without reading the word, something is not okay. I don't feel okay. My spirit is used to this thing because I nourish myself.
Yeah.
Breakfast, lunch, supper, you can eat that. But spiritual breakfast, lunch, supper, do you eat that? You see, Jesus was not there to meet the needs of the flesh. He knew that the people were poor and that they needed food. And after giving them literal food, he presents to them that I can give you more, but their stomachs were not having it. Their stomachs were after the bread and the fish. He says, you follow me because, not because you saw the miracles, not because you can perceive that I am the Christ, not because you can perceive that I'm both the Logos and the Rhema, but because you ate and you were filled. That's why you follow me. And we are a generation that says, Lord, we don't want just your hand. We want your heart.
Amen.
We want your heart.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
Okay? So unmet expectations. When God says no, and will you still worship him? When the gospel is not the gospel of what you can get. When even, let's even say, when the gospel is about God disciplining you, and that is summarized. Let's say that is the gospel. Would you say yes? Jesus says, whoever puts his hand to plow and looks back is not worthy of my kingdom. Amen? He said, not worthy of me. Paul, if it's Paul who wrote Hebrews, in Bible school we must address that. Paul, when, let's say Paul was on, okay? For the sake of, we are not doing hermeneutics. But when he writes, he says that endure discipline as though you are being disciplined by your father, who's more concerned that you might partake of his holiness in life to come. So he benefits you now, and he benefits you in the life to come. So when he says no, trust him. When God says no, trust him. He knows what he's doing. He's more interested in maturing you than in giving you what you want.
Amen.
Okay? When God is crafted according to our needs, he becomes an idol. When we preach a need-centered gospel, we are not preaching Jesus. We are not, hey, come that you might have. Come that you might have. I'm still waiting. They said I should come that I might have peace. I'm waiting for that peace and happiness today. I know joy. I know joy. I know what it is to suffer loss. I know what it is to suffer reproach for the gospel. I'm waiting for happiness. When I came to Jesus, they promised me happiness. I am waiting earnestly to be happy. But I know what it is to have peace. I know what it is when nothing makes sense. Nothing except God. When God is the only thing that makes sense. But nothing makes sense. I know that. I know what it is like not to let me start here, because people think psychologists don't get depressed. Psychologists are the most depressed people you ever meet. Because we carry your problems, our problems, the problems of the country, everyone's problems. We carry them every day. Every day. I know what it is to be depressed, but to have rest in God. To have rest in his way. To have rest in his promises. Let me not preach about myself. But when God is crafted according to how he can meet our needs, he becomes a need-centered God. And he becomes an idol, and then we engage in idolatry, and then we stumble again. Then he becomes a rock of offense. Offense leads to error. False worship is an error. It's like, yes, I can see that red thing behind that one. You see it, that window on your right. You see that red light. You're supposed to go to it. But along the way, you just see no light and you go there. That is what sin is, literally. Is to miss the mark. Is to know what to do. To follow the way that you should go to do that thing. And then along the way, to take a detour. Jesus. So understanding informs practice, not knowledge. When you understand, we will see the way you practice that you understand. Understanding, apart above everything that I'm saying, please get this. Understanding informs practice, not knowledge. You can have a head full of knowledge, full of the scriptures, talking about being at the right hand of God, but not understanding what the right hand of God is, or where it is, if really it's in the right. Or in the left. You get what I'm saying? And you know these verses, you know them, you know the verses. But to understand, that is something that the Spirit can, only the Spirit can give you. Jesus said to, I think he was talking to religious believers, he says, you search the verses. Because in them you think you're going to find life. But life is not found in the verses. It's found in the Spirit that's in the verse. The Bible without the Holy Spirit makes no sense. That is why people can have a PhD in theology, but still stumble at the word. Because you need the Holy Spirit. The words that are spirit in their life, they're explained by the Spirit. The soul of the man, the spirit of the man is the candle of the word. So the words that he speaks will light the candle in you. Typical example, Genesis 3. I hope it's 3. When Adam and Eve partook of the fruit, the Bible says that after they had eaten, their eyes opened. Okay, my question, does it mean that when they were eating, they blindly looked for the tree, and then they found the fruit, and then they ate? Doesn't mean that. So you have to understand which eyes were open. Because I don't think they were roaming around the garden, like blindly looking for a tree, and then, you know, feeling if something is a fruit or something. No. So the Bible without the Holy Spirit makes no sense. Because someone who does not have the Holy Spirit will read that in a literal way. Amen? Okay. Lastly, let's look at what causes us to walk in offense in Christ. It is unbelief. Unbelief is not like doubt. It's not like you having questions. It's not like you wondering like, Lord, how are you going to do this? Honestly, like that is a 49. What's the entry mark? What's the entry mark? The minimum entry mark? Take them. You don't have. Okay, more spoon. What? Okay, let's say it's 40. It's there, standing 39. It's not you are wondering, God, how are you going to do this? Unbelief is when you refuse to let God be God in your life. You can actively refuse God to be God in your life. The memory, you know, when you murmur and you complain, in essence, you are telling God that his government and his lordship over your life is poor. That's why you're complaining. When you are governed and you are led, and the government is not doing its job, you murmur again, you murmur, you complain, you protest, you do it all. So when you are murmuring against God, you are saying that, Father, your leadership,
come on, minister,
your leadership is poor. So unbelief indirectly is saying, God, your leadership is poor. Your leadership is poor. And therefore, that's why many of them walked with him no more. They were like, the bread and the blood, oh, yeah. Right? Fine. So let's go to... Okay? Let's go to Luke 8, 11 to 15. Are we still together, Basara?
Yeah.
Christ is... It's not the rock of offense to us again.
Mm-hmm.
I hope so. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And we look at the parable of the sower. We all know the parable again. Okay? And then let's look at 11, 12. Okay, 13. We are hearing the word. Yes. Aina, King James, 14. Can I just check 14? 14 is the case of life. Okay, 13 is fine. Okay, fine. So the word is planted, the spirit and the life that is in the word is planted, right? When it is planted, it goes to different types of hearts. Woe unto the heart that is walking in offense, because it receives the word with joy. But the word has no root, and it believes the word for a while. In the time of temptation, other version says, in the time of temptation, the people what do what? They fall away. It says, by and by, they are offended. God will not ask you to do things that make sense, because he does not make sense, he makes spirit. So he won't ask you to do the things that make sense. For example, typical example, we are not going to talk about principalities. We are going to talk about issues that happen among us believers. Christ says, when your brother or sister offends you, what shall you do? You call them, you have it between you two. If they don't repent, call three or four people, so that every word is established again. And then if they don't repent still, take it to the church. No repentance, treat that person as a tax collector. Tax collector, we meet when we have business. When we don't have business, we meet. Right? And we meet once. Right? You ask a believer, what do you do when your brother offends you? They start, my God. If I cut you off, chances are you handed me the scissors. What is those quotes? This motivational quotes. I no longer have time for things that do not feed me. I no longer have time for things that don't nurture me. What did the word say?
Amen.
You see, the Christ is becoming a stumbling block unto you.
Mm-hmm.
He's causing you to stumble. He says, eat my bread, eat my flesh, drink my blood. Can you go to Matthew 26 to 27? Christ demands that we die to self. And there's no better way to offend someone than to tell them to die to themselves. Matthew 26:26. Okay, so as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, 27. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink, can you say this person, drink, you, all of it. Say all of it.
All of it.
You don't get to choose how much you drink. You drink the cup, you drink all of it. The blood, have you ever seen where blood is shed? Blood is not shed where something is nice. Blood is shed when something is painful, but you drink the cup. He says, drink all of it. I love that. All of it. Mm-hmm. When he wanted to bail out and said, Father, let this cup pass me by, he drank the cup and he drank all of it. Mm-hmm. Christ leads by example. He drank the cup, he expects you to drink the cup. To drink the cup of persecution. To drink the cup of rejection. Rejection is painful. To drink the cup of contempt. To drink the cup of suffering loss for sake of Christ. And he says, drink it and drink all of it. Now, Jesus, your children don't want to drink the cup. They want to choose how they drink the cup. They want to drink the cup halfway. But he says, if you are to follow me, I want all of it. I want you all in.
Yes.
I want you all in. I want it all. So if you are going to drink, drink the cup. Right? The bread speaks of the death of Christ. Again, he died that we might have life unto Christ. So he died unto us that we might have life unto him. Now, when he says, the words that I speak are spirit and their life. The words of Christ impart life. Paul says, you were dead in sin, but now you are quickened by the Spirit. The word quickens. When you are broken, you can have that one verse. Corinthians, blessed is the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions, that we may comfort other people by the same comfort that we receive from God. The Spirit quickens. The Spirit helps you to overcome sin. Without the word of God dwelling richly in you, you cannot overcome sin. I mean, John said that, right? The Spirit of life helps you to live life unto God, a life of righteousness. Not because of your own strength. You know, have you tried living a holy life out of your own strength? You will fall so hard. Because you are using a weak thing to fight a weaker. You're using a weaker thing to fight a weak thing. So the Holy Spirit imparts life. He quickens you. He makes you to live a life unto God, not by your own works. The life that he speaks about is the God kind of life, the Zoe. Mm-hmm. God is not impressed when his children are depressed. He cries, Jesus. So your soul, body, and spirit, having life. Not that everything is okay. No. But you have the God kind of life in you.
Amen.
And when you have the God kind of life in you, when that candle is lit, people get drawn to it and they want Christ. Amen. So you don't need a tent. And, okay, I'm kidding. You need tents and speakers to evangelize. So John 10:10, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Soul, body, spirit. I came that you might have life. God does not take pleasure when he sees his children suffering. Especially when he's a father who's available. But Basulazula. God does not enjoy seeing that. He does not enjoy seeing you cry on your pillow when we come see you. He does not enjoy that. He delights that we have life and have it abundantly. That we have the God kind of life. The life of righteousness, of holiness, of faith, of purity, of love. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. 5 minutes left. In conclusion, I want to say that the word and the words that, you see, the thing about Jesus is that the word speaks the word. But the word that became flesh, when he spoke the word, he imparted life. Sai spoke that we can speak a multitude of words, but when we do not speak life, we profit no one. We are just like a loud noise. We're just making noise. Amen? So, in conclusion, again, I would just like to urge the saints that, you know what, let's go before God, saying, Father Lord, nevertheless, at your word, we will obey. At your word, we will wash our feet. With your word, that Christ may not be a stumbling block unto us, that as we see him as he is, we may be like him. The Bible says that if we have this hope in us, we'll purify ourselves. So that we, as he appears, we can see him as he is, not as what we think he is, not as we have made him to be, but as he is, because we will be like that as well. The Bible speaks of the man as a mirror, as like light, seed, lamp. Why? Because when you look at the mirror, you should be able to see yourself. The light is supposed to light your path and direct you. But when you're stumbling at the weight, it's when you think your mind is above the will of God, and you will stumble. Because when you stumble, you walk in error, you walk in contempt, you walk in pride, there's the absence of conviction, because you are doing your own thing. But when you say, Lord, nevertheless, at your weight, I will obey. You take the will of the Lord as it is. You put it in you, and it works.
Amen?
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
So I'll just... Okay. Thank you. I would just like us to stand. And let's make a short prayer unto the Lord to say, Heavenly Father, if there's anything in our lives that we have not laid down, reveal it unto us that we may lay down. If there's anything in us that causes us to stumble at your weight, reveal it to us, that Christ may not be a stumbling block unto us. Amen?
Amen. Let's stop here. Let's make a prayer.